ChristianGeekCentral.com.
Do you like games? I like games too. I like games too.
Hey guys, Peter Franson here from ChristianGeekCentral.com and Spirit Blade Productions. Well, I'm ready to wrap up my thoughts on E3 2017. I spent a couple of days just kind of scouring the internet for all of kind of like the gameplay videos and news announcements and stuff that I could get my hands on to kind of soak up as much as I could. And here are my final thoughts and highlights, including my hidden gems from E3 2017 that you might have missed. Starting off with Monster Hunter. I already commented on this a little bit. It's coming in early 2018, but I found out a little bit more information that says to me this could very well be absolutely my kind of game. I don't have any experience with the games in the series, but looking at it now, it's going to have more of a single-player focus than the series has typically had in the past, which is totally my thing, and it's got a dynamic ecosystem that the monsters are living in, and they're preying upon each other, and they can look at a situation that you're in the middle of and choose a side, as it were, and kind of like jump into the fray, and there's a day-night cycle that changes their behavior. The focus on this game, the basic gameplay loop, as I understand it, is finding resources, using them to craft new weapons and armor, tracking down monsters, and killing them to get their stuff, their skins or whatever the crap, and rinse and repeat until you take on, I don't know, I guess all the monsters that you can handle. So anyway, I think based on the further information I've kind of gotten about this series and this particular game, it could be totally right up my alley. So I'm definitely looking forward to checking out Monster Hunter World in early 2018. Maybe the biggest surprise for me in terms of, you know, something that like I'm excited about that was not even on my radar before E3 2017 began is Ubisoft's The Crew 2, which is coming in early 2018. I'm not in particular I'm definitely not a car guy. I don't like going to car shows, or I don't know anything about auto mechanics. I'm not that guy. But I've discovered in open city games like the Saints Row games and Watch Dogs 2, as I've been playing that, and Mad Max, that I kind of enjoy just ripping around in a vehicle and just kind of smashing into things on purpose or usually by accident, and just having a grand old time, you know, navigating whatever environment I'm in. And that's really what this game is going to be all about. As I learned more about it, the original game, The Crew, was focused more on traveling on roads, and it wasn't open. It was gated by a lot of like races that you had to win at or whatever. And that really tends to be an annoying part of the way Ubisoft makes their games, is they have these big wide open game worlds in their games, but then there'll be certain sections of them that are gated that you can't get to until you've accomplished some certain story mission. Well, they have listened to their fans, at least on this game, and hopefully they'll do it for the Far Cry 5 and Assassin's Creed Origins as well. And they have just made the entire world open from the get-go, and also you don't have to compete in races in order to like unlock things, which I understand would be like new vehicles, and other little bells and whistles that you can play with. But the world itself is open from the get-go, and anywhere your vehicle can take you, you can go. And there are like four different paths of involvement that you can engage in order to kind of unlock things, gain points, or whatever the progression point system is, experience or whatever, I don't know. But the different types there are, let's see, street racing, pro racing. So street racing is just on city streets. Pro racing is on like professional tracks. Freestyling, which I'm not sure what that means, maybe like ramps and stunts and stuff like that. Or exploring. So in other words, that last category means that you can progress through the game unlocking things simply by basically going places, it sounds like. You can also, and I didn't believe this at first, I had to have it confirmed, you can switch between vehicle types at the press of a button. So that means that you can ramp off the top of like some multi-story parking garage and then midair switch to a plane and fly for a bit and then fly over the water and then switch to a boat and you'll drop down, hit the water running, and in a speedboat. And then also there's this crazy nonsensical Inception type reality bending where like half the city can start like turning up on its edge into a 90 degree angle, and you can just race right up that or find yourself like on the slope and then having to go down, and then I mean it's crazy. I don't know what is going on there. In the interviews, they didn't provide a story justification for it. They were just like, because it's cool, you know? So, you know, normally I'm only into games that have some kind of what I would call a nerd genre or geek genre element. So sci-fi, fantasy, horror, something fantastical. And so normally I wouldn't be into a game like this, but there's just enough kind of gamey things going on that it feels like a kind of a nerd fantasy, you know? I'm like, I'm turning to any vehicle man, you know, and I'm flying and driving around a twisty, bendy Inception-style world. Hey, that's whatever. It doesn't have to make sense. I'm just going to enjoy playing in that, I think. The question for me will be, will I enjoy the vehicle control? Because I've only basically played Watch Dogs 2 and had the experience with the vehicles there, and I don't like that control for the vehicles as well as, like, say, for the Saints Row games or for Sleeping Dogs. So that's still a big question in my mind. The other big question in my mind was, can you play this game offline? And no, you can't, which was kind of a bummer to me. I really prefer solo experiences so that Monkey Dookie 698 is not going to be ticking me off and ramming into me or blocking the thing that I'm interested in doing or whatever. So that's a little bit frustrating, but from what I can tell, you don't actually need a PS Plus membership. I have no reason to have a PlayStation Plus membership because I just don't play online games. And this is like, crap, is this really going to be like behind a paywall basically just to play the game at all? And from the research that I've done, from the best I can tell, you don't. You'll still be in an online persistent world that will have other players, you know, that are driving around you and stuff and can potentially knock into you and stuff. But you won't be able to participate in any races or team up with anybody, which is fine by me. So this is actually a game that I might be willing to try playing online, even if I got to drive around with Monkey Dookie, just so that I can enjoy all that the game world has to offer. So I'm not, you know, it's not an insta-buy for me, but I'm definitely strongly going to be considering The Crew 2. I didn't get much more information about Metro Exodus 2018 than what we already saw and what I picked up just from watching the demo at the Microsoft press conference. It's coming out in 2018. It was described in a developer walkthrough as survival sandbox, which was interesting to me because I'm only about halfway through maybe the first of the two Metro games that have been released already. And I wouldn't describe it as a sandbox game. It's more of an atmospheric, kind of like Bioshocky type, except it's, you know, harder, ammo is more scarce, and it's easier to die for me. So it may be that this series is going to be too difficult for me to consistently enjoy. It'll just be too intense of an experience than what I want when I'm just relaxing at the end of my workday. But what I'm going to do, because I love sandbox games, is continue playing through the Metro games that I have and see if that'll help me make my decision on whether or not I'm going to pick up Metro Exodus when it comes out. It comes out sometime in 2018. The PlayStation 4 Spider-Man game, I had some serious reservations about during the footage we saw at the conference because it looked full of QuickTime button prompts, and I am not into that. What I wanted was an open city Spider-Man game. Well, during a developer walkthrough on, I think, a Sony stage or somewhere, it was confirmed by the developers to be an open world game outside of the main missions. So this game is now officially back on my radar. It's definitely not one that I'm going to insta-buy, and I wouldn't even say that I'm like excited for it yet, because what I've found in some open world games is it can be really frustrating to have story missions that have like a totally different play style than the open world activities. And that can almost be enough in some cases to suck the fun out of me, or at least make me suck the fun out of the experience for me. Excuse me. I guess it kind of sucks the fun out of me. I'm probably be a grumpy guy to sit next to when I'm having those experiences. But I mean, bad enough that I'd be like, you know what? I'm putting this game away for a while, you know? And I don't like that. I don't like to be frustrated enough with a game that I'm putting it away for a month or two. So anyway, but it is at least back on my radar because of the confirmation that it is, in fact, outside of the story missions, an open city Spider-Man game. Could be very cool. Okay, now I want to talk about my hidden gems, the video games that I saw, maybe knew about going into E3, maybe didn't until I started looking at E3 coverage, but that didn't get coverage kind of like on the big show, the big stage shows and stuff like that. The first one is Agents of Mayhem. This is coming out soon. It's coming out August 15th in the United States and on August 18th in Europe. And this is made by the people who did the Saints Row games, which I've already referenced. So I am a fan of Saints Row 2 and 3 and much of 4, although it's it's a very different kind of game, and they take a lot of the superpower elements from 4, and they are just running with it in this game, where you can control, you can make a squad, or is it a squad when there's just 3, or do you have to have 4 for a squad? Anyway, you have a team of 3 of these agents of mayhem that are going out and trying to stop this other diabolical evil team, or whatever, I think it's called Legion. And you can take 3 agents out into the city at a time, but you only control 1 at a time, and they kind of like swap. So like the others are in some kind of digital limbo, I guess, and then at the press of a button, you can swap out 1 of those 3 agents, and each has their own unique powers and abilities that are useful to the situation at hand. And, you know, the way that you load out your team of 3, you know, might be dependent on how those abilities interact with each other when you alternate back and forth really quickly, and given the situations that you're in. So it sounds like there's some, you know, cool action RPG type gameplay, and also some like bigger picture zoomed out kind of strategy in terms of how you select your team members for a mission, and then also just like the crazy off the wall humor of the Saints Row games can really be funny, especially when they play to some of like the retro, you know, elements from, you know, that like people, I guess, of my generation would know about. The humor can be a little bit crass sometimes, and you know, that can be a, you know, a bummer of a thing, but I think I'm really going to enjoy it. If my history with the games is any indicator, I think by and large the good things are going to far outshine, in my experience, the things that I don't like as much. So yeah, looking forward to Agents of Mayhem on August 15th. Vampire is a game coming out in November 2017. This game was not on my radar, really, until I started looking at it at E3. The description, I still don't know very much about it. The description from the developers reads, London, 1918. You are a newly turned vampire, Dr. Jonathan Reed. As a doctor, you must find a cure to save the city's flu-ravaged citizens. As a vampire, you are cursed to feed on those you vowed to heal. Will you embrace the monster within? Survive and fight against vampire hunters, undead skull, and other monstrosities. Use your unholy powers to manipulate and delve into the lives of those around you to decide who will be your next victim. Struggle to live with your decisions. Your actions will save or doom London. In gameplay, you have to feed, basically, to become stronger, which is going to help you progress through the game, but this results in killing people, which as a doctor, you're going to be totally against. And so the game is largely about making these difficult decisions of who am I going to feed on, you know, what kind of person am I going to choose to feed on. And since I suck at games and I'm going to be looking for every advantage I can find to get through a game like this, I'm going to violate the crap out of my Hippocratic Oath if I play Vampire. But I love the idea that there's this cost involved in the simple choice of feeding as a vampire in a video game. I'm hoping that the combat, that the powers that you can gain and develop, that the progression and upgrade systems are all cool and satisfying. So I definitely want to know a lot more than I know now, but Vampire, coming out in November 2017, is definitely on my radar. Elex, coming out October 17th, is one that I remember seeing a little bit of, I think, last year at E3, and then I totally forgot about it again. So I know very little. There's still very little that's been revealed about this game, apart from what looks like a visually interesting world and the ingredients of kind of post-apocalyptic-ish sci-fi mashed up with fantasy. So there's like, you know, like missiles and bombs and stuff, and also like magic spells, and it's an open world RPG, like third-person action type RPG. There's some stiff like jumping animations in some of the gameplay videos that I've seen. I'm like, I don't know, and that kind of gives me pause. But I can forgive a lot personally visually if the gameplay systems are enjoyable. So, you know, if you let me explore and loot and upgrade, I usually don't need a whole lot more. That can be a very satisfying experience all by itself. So unless pre-release reviews are universally terrible, I at least want to give LX a try when it comes out October 17th. And the final hidden gem on my radar is called Kingdom Come Deliverance. This one's coming out February 13th, 2018. It used to use, during, I think, its Kickstarter the tagline Dungeons, No Dragons. And it's been compared to Skyrim. It's a first-person medieval RPG, but with no magic. Instead, emphasizing other, you know, detailed systems that are simulating the historical environment and the historical day-to-day, you know, kind of activities. Elements like medieval weaponry, armor, and melee combat. Where you have armor on your body is like, that's a major factor. And like, how heavy your armor is going to block your line of sight. If you have like a helmet with a visor, that's going to block your visibility quite a bit as a player. And then, also I think how you can move and stuff. So it's really trying to simulate a lot of those kinds of down and dirty physics of like living in a cruddy medieval world. And it also has detailed charisma and interaction systems and reputation systems. It does have a few video gamey fantasy elements like potions, and there is a skill in there called alchemy, which makes me think, okay, are we going to be trying to turn lead into gold here? Are we going to succeed in that? Is that a thing? Or visually, I got to say, it looks a little bland, but that's in part maybe due to its realistic setting. It'll just be interesting to see how it ultimately comes out. It is being made by a very small team, so I'm not expecting AAA visuals. The combat, though, is what maybe concerns me a little bit, because in previews it seems like it might be pretty hard and unforgiving, and I don't have good reflexes or like hand-eye coordination or really fast response time. I'm just not that kind of player at all. So in this world, like, they say if you break a finger, you're kind of like a dead man because of how that's going to affect your, you won't be able to wield a sword if you break, you know, your fingers. But there are also supposedly a much greater variety of ways to complete quests compared to, say, a game like Skyrim, allowing for non-combat solutions, I think, much more frequently, if not all the time. Like Skyrim, though, skills develop by practicing them, by using them. So the developers say it's worth trying all kinds of approaches to different quests in order to develop your character. I almost always need, as I mentioned earlier, some element of the fantastic to enjoy a video game, but this game may be my second rare exception, along with The Crew 2. This could be absolutely the wrong game for me, but I'm very curious and I want to give it a try because of what it could end up being for me. So again, that's Kingdom Come Deliverance, releasing February 13th, 2018. All right, I just want to fly through really fast the results of my wishes, which ones are granted, which ones weren't. Actually, I'm just going to give you some highlights. This list is way too long. I had 13 granted out of my 45 wishes. All 7 of my most anticipated games this year, which I'll talk about at the end, are coming in 6 to 9 months. That's like amazing to me. There were some great moments of transparency from both Sony and Nintendo presentations, so that was a nice wish granted. Another wish that I did not think would be granted was games featuring and emphasizing couch co-op and a reason to have people over and to offer hospitality in bringing people into your living space, into your home to spend time with you. I think that's something, if we can encourage more of that, especially as Christians, that's something that we really want to be about. So there's A Way Out, which is a really cool looking game about two guys that agree to work together in order to escape a prison. And then there's also Hidden Agenda, which I found about a day or two later. This is a game where you are playing two characters that are investigating you're trying to track down a serial killer. But the decisions that are being made in the game can be made with, I think, up to 4 players other than yourself, maybe. So like a total of maybe 5 people sitting down and playing this game and helping to make decisions. It's made by the people who made Until Dawn. And so it's largely a story-based game that you're kind of like choosing your own adventure as you go through it. That's kind of like the level of involvement. I don't know how much controlling of the avatars on screen you're actually doing. But given that it's not a fantastical genre story, it's just a crime story, I'm thinking to myself, okay, well, people that like aren't geeks, aren't hardcore gamers, aren't used to all the weirdness that can come in thematically with video games, but maybe they watch CSI, you know, they might be into this, you know. So I could almost imagine sitting down actually with my wife and my parents playing a game like this, and they would totally be into it, you know. So anyway, I think this could actually be, going with the whole serial killer angle, could be that perfect meeting point that I couldn't imagine what it could be between the hardcore gamer and the non-gamer or the casual gamer who maybe is into some TV shows but isn't going to be into crazy weirdness, you know. Same thing could be said for A Way Out, where it has kind of like this gritty story to it. You know, isn't there a show called Prison Break that was pretty popular? I don't know. I didn't watch it. But I mean, I can see how these could be really great meeting points between hardcore gamers and casual or non-gamers. So yeah, really, really cool. Hopefully both of those games are really successful and we'll see more games that encourage actually socializing in person with other people and practicing hospitality. Such a cool thing. Okay, I'm gonna go much faster on the rest of these. The next wish granted was entertainment, and not a ton of really interesting entertainment, but man, that the hanging Cirque du Soleil zombies during the Sony conference has to count for something. That was crazy. There was no bridging the gap really between to the PC from Xbox on Xbox's part, so that was not granted. There was no announcement or word of Elder Scrolls 6. In fact, there was a little confirmation a couple days later from some media outlet that in fact, yes, currently there is still no development whatsoever being done on Elder Scrolls 6. So that was a bummer. No Zelda Maker being announced. I didn't get my favorite games on the eShop. In fact, Nintendo said nothing about the eShop. Does the eShop even exist anymore? You Nintendo fans, have you checked? My gosh. There was no BioShock 4 announced, no Singularity 2 announced, no Open City single player DC Universe / Justice League of America action RPG announced, no new Snowblind style action RPG announced, Pillars of Eternity 2 is not coming to console as far as I know, there was no Bloodstained or Symphony of the Night clones with release dates for 2017 announced. Oh man, this was maybe a big one. No Dragon Quest XI announcement for release in the US. I really kind of thought it was going to happen. And it never happened. I'm baffled. They brought over three games to the US that are based in the Dragon Quest world. But not this mainline, there's no indication that this mainline Dragon Quest game is, I don't know, maybe they're going to see if they can milk people for the second Dragon Quest Heroes game. Has that released yet? I think it has. I don't know what they're waiting for. Anyway, all right. And then the last one was a wish that did get granted, and that was just some new RPGs to get announced. And I definitely felt like Alex kind of fit the bill on that one, and maybe something else I mentioned. I don't know. My brain is so fried. I can't remember what I've talked about. Despite having relatively few of my wishes granted, I've got to say, this E3 left me with more games I'm looking forward to in the near future than any E3 I can remember. It was really kind of shocking to me as I kind of thought about, oh man, I'm kind of disappointed, but wait a minute, holy crap, as I started counting up. So let me tell you about my most anticipated games coming out of E3 2017. The first one is Agents of Mayhem, that's coming out again in August, and I'm definitely looking forward to that. I've already said a little bit about that. The next one that's coming out, this will be the very first of my most anticipated game that's released, is Final Fantasy XII, The Zodiac Age. I loved this game on PlayStation 2, not as much the first time I played it. The second time I played it years later, I was like, this is amazing. Why didn't I think this was amazing the first time I played it? And I'm very much looking forward to playing it again. It's possible that, you know, I'll get 10 hours into it and say, yep, I remember all this. I don't need to play anymore. But there's a part of me I think there's an equal chance that I will just totally get absorbed in it all over again because I love the combat system in that game. It's the same kind of real-time with pause combat that I love from Dragon Age Origins and Neverwinter Nights and Pillars of Eternity. It's very similar to those real-time with pause systems. And all the manipulation you can do of the artificial intelligence of each of the characters in your party, I mean, there's just so much going on in that game. You can count on me doing a video about that game when it comes out. So very much looking forward to that. Then a big surprise, The Crew 2. Very good chance that I'll be buying that. I'm not for sure on that, but very good chance that I'll be buying that. It looks like it could totally be a blast. LX, I already mentioned. I'm very curious about that one. Just looking forward to an open world action RPG in any kind of sci-fi genre, even if it's split between sci-fi and fantasy. Outside of Fallout, it's not very often we get an open world RPG in the sci-fi genre. So I'm definitely looking forward to that. Now, the three that I would say I'm most looking forward to would be the Horizon Zero Dawn expansion. Yeah, I've got my issues with Aloy, but I really enjoyed the gameplay of Horizon Zero Dawn. And so I'm definitely looking forward to an excuse to get back in there and build up my levels in all the different parts of the world that I haven't cleared out yet so that I can take on whatever the big badness is that's coming with the DLC expansion. Very much looking forward to that. And then the two games that I'm most looking forward to as coming out of E3 are the two games I was most looking forward to seeing more of going into E3. That's Far Cry 5 and Assassin's Creed Origins. So as you can imagine, like the winner of E3, if there's a winner in Peter Franzen's experience, is Ubisoft. I guess I'm just like a freaking Ubisoft fanboy now. I just seem to like their formula for making games, this kind of open world thing where you go around and you collect goodies and you just kind of move around and explore this world. And yeah, do some other combat and other stuff here and there, you know, but mostly it's just about exploring and collecting and upgrading and I've really, and these are games also that I feel like I can have reasonable hope for, because I am three games, maybe four, how many, I think one, two, I'm at least three games into Assassin's Creed right now, and I'm not bored of this formula. And if they keep, I know they're changing quite a bit, so there is a little bit of question there. Are they going to be changing too much? I don't know. But I'm at this point, I'm kind of ready to give them the benefit of the doubt, even with the glitches that I know are going to be coming as I continue progressing through the Assassin's Creed series as I am for the first time. Like when I get to Unity, there'll probably be some issues that are annoying, or I'll discover all these things that other gamers have discovered before me, you know. But I suspect that this formula, I'm going to continue to enjoy, just as I have with Far Cry, the Far Cry games. I really enjoyed 2. I'm still playing and collecting diamonds in 2, also in 3, also in 4. I'm really enjoying these games. I think I'm really going to enjoy Far Cry 5. I think that between Far Cry 5 and Assassin's Creed Origins, those are, if I can have a more sure bet than some other things that I'm kind of looking forward to, I think those are probably my most sure bets. And certainly the most sure bets I've ever had of any game I'm looking forward to coming out of E3. So anyway, those are my most anticipated games of E3 2017. And I am now ready to actually start playing games. Oh my gosh, I have been listening to people talk about games, I've been watching footage of games, I've been putting in a lot of extra time, and I am ready. I'm actually thinking I'm going to take the last day this week off. I want to play some games. My gosh. Having this carrot dangled in front of me all week long. I'm also going to be playing games next Friday, June 23rd, right here on youtube.com/ChristianGeekCentral and at ChristianGeekCentral.com. I'll embed it there as well. And you're invited to join me as I live stream games that I will be playing in anticipation of my most anticipated games. I am picking at least one game for all of my most anticipated games that shares some quality in common with that anticipated game. Maybe it's an earlier game in the series, maybe it's a totally different game that has a very similar mechanic or scratches a very similar itch, but that's how I'm going to decide what I will be playing out of my backlog as I burn through my backlog in an effort to be responsible with my finances this summer as we continue celebrating the summer of free at Christian Geek Central. So anyway, you're invited to join me right here for 4 to 10 p.m. Pacific next Friday, June 23rd. I hope you'll come and hang out and have fun with me as we continue to geek out and seek the truth.